The bankers would then bribe the leaders of those countries not to pay back the loans. Their third world puppets would sign agreements stating that when the country defaulted, the banks would be given all the natural resources and infrastructure of the once sovereign lands. But worst of all, the countries would pledge future taxes paid by the people in perpetuity as profit to the private banks. By the year 2000, there were few nations that had not fallen to the designs of the money power. The globalists were now ready to start their final phase of world government takeover, the destruction of the Western nations' economies. To carry out their final takeover, they first removed banking regulations like the Glass-Steagall Act in the late 1990s. This allowed their front companies to issue unlimited credit to the world and to set up colossal Ponzi schemes, the likes of which the world had never seen. The scams were advertised by the controlled corporate media as completely legitimate. Because of the fantastic returns, private investors, corporations, state and local governments invested heavily. They had taken the bait, hook, line, and sinker. To destroy confidence, in late 2007, the bankers themselves began to badmouth the scams they had created. Next, the central bankers cut off the tsunami of fiat money that they had been using to pump up the bubble. When Congress and the public refused to write the finance oligarchs a blank check, the bankers began to engage in financial terrorism. They said that the world would go into another Great Depression unless their demands were met, further destroying confidence. The stock market instantly had its biggest one-day loss in history, but even that wasn't enough to force Congress to capitulate to the offshore banks. Senator Inhofe of Oklahoma and Congressman Brad Sherman of California, amongst others, told the world that the entire Congress had been threatened with martial law by the White House and the Treasury Department if they didn't pass the so-called banker bailout bill.
The only way they can pass this bill is by creating and sustaining a panic atmosphere. That atmosphere is not justified. Many of us were told in private conversations that if we voted against this bill on Monday, that the sky would fall, the market would drop 2,000 or 3,000 points the first day, another couple thousand the second day, and a few members were even told that there would be martial law in America if we voted no. That's what I call fear-mongering. Unjustified.
The final version of the bill was kept secret from the Congress until minutes before the vote on October 3, 2008. The Federal Reserve had promised total transparency, that every dime would be accounted for.
To Democrats and Republicans who've opposed this plan, I say, step up to the plate. Let's do what's right for the country at this time, because the time to act is now. To prevent the possibility of a crisis turning into a catastrophe.
After its passage, the public learned with horror that the bill was really a financial coup d'etat by Wall Street. The bill didn't just give $700 billion to the banks. It was a blank check. And as of February 2009, $9.7 trillion has disappeared into a black hole. Within 24 hours of its passage, Secretary of Treasury Henry Paulson said they were no longer going to use the money to unfreeze the mortgage market by buying bad debt.
We went to Congress. Illiquid assets look like the way to go. As the situation worsened, the facts change. I will never apologize for changing an approach or strategy when the facts change.
Paulson has, in the meantime, admitted that the subprime mortgage crisis is not the cause, really, of the breakdown of the entire world banking system and the bankruptcy of most of the banks in London and in Wall Street. He said, oh, we're going to buy up toxic assets, but we're not going to worry about subprime mortgages. What he's talking about is derivatives. Derivatives are the center of the crisis.
He went on to say that where the money was going was a secret. I believe that banking institutions are more dangerous to our liberties than standing armies. If the American people ever allow private banks to control the issuance of their currency, first by inflation, then by deflation. The banks and corporations that will grow up around the banks will deprive the people of all property until their children wake up homeless on the continent their fathers conquered. The issuing power should be taken from the banks and restored to the people to whom it properly belongs. Thomas Jefferson, 3rd President of the United States.
Secretary Paulson came in with the Vice President and Fed Chairman Bernanke and made all these assurances that there was absolutely a critical, immediate need to get rid of the corrosive derivative products, you know, all the different names for this, and you know, ubiquitous, you know, sub-S retraded credit default swap, blah, 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 blah. Okay? But they talked about them as though they knew what the hell they were. You got the money and you immediately said, what items, what auction?
Now, the Treasury just basically cut that out of the bill. And what, you know, what we have here is a situation where banks are hoarding the money that they're getting from the TARP. They're using the money to purchase other banks. And all of a sudden, the Treasury sent a signal to the banks, forget about it. We're going to give you the money that you want, and you do what you want with it. Unless you direct it specifically, it's not going to happen. I don't think anyone questions, Mr. Kashkari, that you're working hard. Our question is who you're working for.
Throughout its passage, President Bush and Senator Obama worked in tandem to get Congress to pass the bill without even having time to read it, despite the fact that in major polls, 98% of the American people were against the bill. The leadership in both parties were for it.
And I really want to commend Barack Obama, because as we were involved in the this and that and different provisions of the bill to persuade people, he really gave them confidence that this was the right decision for the American people, even though it wasn't, in our view, a great bill for them to vote on.
I want to take a particular moment to also thank an individual who's not here, and that is Barack Obama, who made numerous calls not only to all of us, but to members of our caucus and helped us gather the votes on the Democratic side to pass this legislation.
Bank heads then bragged to the press that they were hoarding the bailout money and using it to buy up smaller, healthy banks and insurance companies. Their plan was working like a charm. Next, the central bankers loaned the federal government back $787 billion of our own money at interest for President Obama's so-called stimulus package. And just like the banker bailout, Congress was given less than an hour to read the 1,070-page-plus stimulus bill. Barack Obama, who had pledged on the campaign trail to wait 5 days before a bill could be voted on so that the Congress and the people could have a chance to read it, said that the stimulus was too important and it had to be passed before anybody could see it or read it, or the crisis would turn into a catastrophe.
Doing little or nothing at all will result in even greater deficits, even greater job loss, even greater loss of income, and even greater loss of confidence. Those are deficits that could turn a crisis into a catastrophe, and I refuse to let that happen.
After its Friday passage, in gangster fashion, President Barack Obama took a four-day vacation and said that there was no rush to sign it. The spending bill was really a takeover bill designed to further federalize the states and to pay off rich donors that had donated to both parties. As the world slid deeper into depression, the bankers celebrated the fire sale that they had created.
I believe this, the phrase burdens of the office is overstated. Yes, can I? Why me? Oh, the burdens. Why did the financial collapse have to happen on my watch? It's just pathetic, isn't it? Self-pity. And I don't believe President-elect Obama will be full of self-pity.
With their access to unlimited fiat capital, they could now buy up sectors of the world economy not already controlled by them.